Sort of very empirically driven, so I understand you, there are many more theoretical people here, so please, if you don't understand or whatever, just give me a bad look or something. So I try to also connect to you with questions. So I'm completely aware that this is probably the most biological lesson you will have here, so I try my best. So intuitively, when we talk about visual awareness, there are three main factors. So one is what we would call the prerequisites or enabling factors. The second would be the actual substrates, or what we would call content. And the third would be the consequences, the cognition, the motor output, everything that would come with your visual awareness, especially when you are about to report it to somebody else or to yourself. Those processes don't have to go necessarily in a sequence, but I think as we talk about the neuronal correlates of visual awareness, we should keep in mind that we have those three aspects. So let's start very easy, sort of. What are the prerequisites for visual awareness? So one prerequisite is that you are actually alert and awake and not sleeping, okay? There needs to be some sort of sensory input, at least when we talk about awareness of the external environment. Obviously, there are sleeps and dreams as well. And we do need an intact transmission from the sensory pathways, basically from the retina to the visual cortex, and this I will detail out a little later.
Did you put the Japanese flag on purpose here?
No. But do you actually see the low contrast one? Because
yes.
This,
yes.
Okay. So, okay. When we try to evaluate whether somebody is awake, how would we do that? Or let's just say, raise your hand if you think that your neighbor is awake. Good. So how did you know that?
The last 30 minutes I've been talking to him.
That's one, something else, like the ones who were not talking. I guess you judge it because this is one, like your neighbor had the eyes open, right? Now, the more difficult question is how you know that your neighbor is conscious. So whoever thinks that the neighbor is conscious raises the hand. Oh, so from what did you conclude it?
He's awake.
Okay.
I think that's about it.
So awake, you judge it because he had the eyes open. Something
eyes
else?
Open.
You were saying you were talking to a neighbor, so that would be also an indication that somebody is consciously aware. And in principle, this is all when you have a patient in a coma, for example, this is all the neurologists can do, sort of at first glance. And this is what they do. So this is sort of the pre-fi neurological area. But this is how neurologists evaluate whether somebody is conscious or not, right? They look at the eyes, so that's what you just did. Then they start to make some verbal commands, please raise your hand, please say your name, and things like that. And they look at motor behavior. So they, if you don't move in response, they are going to scratch your foot and they are going to sort of squeeze you and see whether you respond. So that's, and from there, the judgment will be done whether you are awake and whether you are conscious or not.
Is this still the clinical standard?
The clinical coma scale is still used, yeah. So every neurologist would understand that.
This is the
you even find that in publications. So, yeah.
Can you use this for people listening to a lecture?
Mm-mm. Let's try. okay, eyes opening, yes, right. So that would give you a 4. I guess. Please raise your hand. You have all done that. That would give us, that I cannot really judge. Okay. That may be also the case, but I guess it's more this. So that would be like 4 plus 5 makes 9. And then we have the motor, withdrawal, painful stimuli. I don't even have to test because you are all spontaneously moving. So that would give you 4, 4, 8 plus 5, 13. So that's good. Good. So that would actually make you conscious. Good. But obviously, this is not really perfect. Neurologists do not just rely on this. They also look at the EEG just to be really safe. Then if you have, so you know what EEG is, so you basically just put electrodes on the scalp, you measure the scalp potentials, which are reflecting the electrical activity in your brain, and then there is an index you can use, it's called bispectral index, is the ratio between high and low frequencies. So if a neurologist sees something like that, if this is like a one second scale, let's say, and it looks like this, that's bad. If it looks like this, a lot of high gamma power, that's probably even faster than that, that's good. Okay. So this is obviously very crude measures. But the real complications start the moment there is a dissociation between the arousal and the actual awareness. So now I has talked about a little bit yesterday. There are multiple dimensions. We have even discussed it shortly. There are different dimensions to consciousness. So one is the arousal, and the other one is the awareness. And it's important to dissociate between those two dimensions because they can be dissociated. If somebody is brain dead, it's very easy. So arousal is low, and the awareness is also low. The EEG is flat. So this is really a lot of evidence that there is no consciousness. The vegetative state has the interesting feature that the arousal can be very high. I'm going to show that to you in a second a little bit more in detail, but the awareness is low. Then there is the minimal conscious state. That's a concept that has been introduced maybe about 10 years ago, and it has been very useful. Stephen Lawrence is one of the real promoters of that sort of insertion of this additional state, because those are patients where the arousal is also high, like in the vegetative state, but their awareness fluctuates. And then there's the locked-in syndrome, which where awareness and arousal are both high, but those patients cannot respond anymore. So if in most cases they can still do eye blinks, but yeah, so then in this case, you would judge either from the EEG or by like the blinking response, whether somebody is conscious or not. In order to understand what sort of enables this basic so awareness and alertness, we can look at brain lesions that lead to deficits in such. So that this is also what we are going to do during the lecture in order to understand a process. There are obviously multiple ways you can do that, but one of the ways is to look at the brain lesions when this function is not there anymore. There are many brain lesions that are interfering with arousal and wakefulness and also consciousness. Those are typically widespread cortical lesions, lesions in the thalamus, and often lesions in the brainstem. So the etiology is usually traumata or stroke or hypoxic brain damage. So if somebody was in a fire, for example, and breathed too much CO2, then you would often get like this completely diffuse brain lesions. The structure that is really important for understanding how general alertness works is what we call the ascending reticular system. In terms of the brain anatomy, this is the reticular formation, and the reticular formation is sending fibers basically to the whole brain. So it's a super totally diffuse system. It also consists of multiple nuclei, and this is really important because if you have a lesion here, you are definitely not going to be awake, and the locked-in syndrome patients have a lesion just below it. So the motor functions don't work, like the spinal cord is sort of disconnected from the rest of the brain, but you need a really clean-cut lesion to just have a motor problem without having any consciousness problems. Yeah, etiologies, I told you. So here, some of the definitions again. So coma is defined by being unarousable, no matter what you do, and unresponsible, also unresponsive, so even if you tweeze, for example, the toe. So no response to painful stimuli, for loud noises, and such. The recovery is completely, it can go either direction. It depends a little on the timing. So it can, yeah. So you can fall in coma and completely wake up after 3 days, or you can go into a minimal conscious state or vegetative state. The vegetative state, I have mentioned before, has the feature that the arousal is very high. So you can see that. So this is Terry Shivago. You probably know her from the press or the media. Terry Shivago, there was a lot of lawsuits because I think the relatives did not want to take off.
Sorry again, but can you just redefine arousal?
Arousal is, in this case, operational, defined by eye opening.
Eye opening only?
Eye opening. Mm-hmm. Eye opening and...
Also eye movement?
The eye movement, depending on what sort of eye movement it is, it would almost fall more into the awareness. So there are different types of eye movements. So, for example, smooth pursuit, you cannot really... do without actually perceiving the stimulus and without sort of purposefully doing it. So that's eye movements, eye opening. Eye opening and also sleep wake cycle. So the EEG sort of shows also gamma activity. Not just, but in this case, if you have high delta activity, your eyes would be closed.
And other reflexes are not counting in your
Oh, there are reflexes that...
Okay, so yeah. Motor reflexes and...
Yeah, so there are different levels of reflexes
so
too.
So this is arousal.
Yeah. And the patients in the vegetative state, they have also normal sleep-wake cycles. And yeah, reflexive motor activity, as I said, so that there are sort of very simple reflexes that also babies have, like the grasp reflex, for example. And there are more higher level deficits, but they don't show any sign of purposeful motor behavior. What does that mean? Like, if they may just do something like this, but they may not reach like this and really shape the hand, for example. The full recovery is rare, and either results then in permanent or minimal conscious state. So the vegetative state is sort of an artifact of the new apparatus medicine, because in earlier days, you would simply not have survived such a lesion. And the minimal conscious state is, I told you already, is a sort of new category, but it has been useful because it does predict the recovery. And yeah, and it's also important to know whether the patient is still conscious. So there seems to be a subpopulation of the vegetative patients who are sometimes seem to be also aware of the surroundings. So sometimes, and not always, and this is also why it makes it so difficult, because it is most often some fluctuating state, they can follow simple commands, like lift your hand, for example, and blink for me. And they do sometimes gestural or verbal responses. They just say something that even makes sense from time to time, but as I said, just time to time. And purposeful behavior, and here we are again, so they sometimes reach really for objects, so they would really shape their hands, and they have pursuit eye movements. So pursuit eye movements would be difficult to assess if somebody doesn't see, because you really cannot make this very smooth following movement without having an extra stimulus there. So if somebody is not really seeing well, because there is a lesion in the visual cortex, you cannot really assess it. But if somebody is following, you can say that he is also aware of the finger, for example, that goes in front of him. And it's also very difficult to fake. So if you are just not looking at anything and you don't have a moving stimulus, for example, your eye movement pattern, if you would really analyze it, it goes like, so, yeah. And those patients also sometimes show appropriate smiling and emotional reactions.
What percent of patients
we really cover by this? So the estimate is that about 20% of the patients that were classified as vegetative are actually minimal conscious, and then it is a graded issue, right? What would recovery mean? Like full recovery, like going to university, extremely rare. Like staying at home, it really depends on the brain lesions you have and how you define recovery, really.
Yeah. Recovery case. This is depend on the way that.
Exactly. So this is the point I'm coming to now. I just wanted to be a little bit more precise on the definitions we have heard from now yesterday, but I wanted to be a little bit more anatomical. So now I has mentioned it yesterday already. But if you look at the brain activity that is associated with different levels of consciousness disorders, then you see that this is, for example, a PET study. PET is an imaging method where you inject a radioactive tracer and it tracks the glucose levels in the brain. And if the brain cells are very active, then they take in a lot of glucose, and this is what you see. And conscious controls would have just in a regular resting state, would have a lot of activity in the precuneus. It seems to be important, and you see like an overall, it's not a super precise method, but you see like an overall glucose uptake in the whole cortex. The vegetative state, in comparison to the conscious controls, you see overall reduced levels also in terms of cortical glucose uptake. But the precuneus is also not really active. The locked-in syndrome sort of looks like the conscious controls. And the minimal conscious state is somewhere in between, yeah, the conscious controls and the vegetative state. You see there's still activity in the precuneus, and there's also overall a little bit more activity. So what seems to be important as a result from this sort of studies is that precuneus and adjacent posterior cingulate cortex is active. I believe Nao has mentioned it yesterday as well, here a little bit more in detail. So that's a study from Melanie Bolli. They have studied patients in the vegetative state and in the minimal conscious state. And they have looked at functional connectivity, so they would call effective connectivity. Those are dynamic causal modeling methods, where you try basically to predict the activity in one area based on the activity in the other area. And they found that the functional connectivity between the prefrontal cortex and the parietal cortex was decreased in patients in the vegetative state. And the frontal to temporal functional connectivity, or in this case, affective connectivity, you would say, was more reduced in the patients in the vegetative state in comparison to the controls and minimal conscious state patients. And again, the minimal conscious state patients are somewhere lying in between here. And based on those results, in this case, they used auditory stimuli, not visual stimuli, which are sort of really impractical in a way. To assess consciousness levels. but based on those results, the neurologists, for example, Melanie Bolli or Stephen Lawrence, they always would say, yes, we believe that if you want to have a sustained level of general consciousness, you need to have the frontal parietal connectivity